In all the excitement generated by the phenomenal and no doubt well-deserved success of Indian novelists writing in English today, one often tends to overlook the fact that English is, after all, only one of India's 18 officially recognized languages and only one of its 200 odd dialects.
പക്ഷേ ചെമ്പൻ പൂവെനിക്കുതരിൻ കുന്നിക്കുരു കണ്ണെനിക്കുതരിൻ എൻ്റെ കോഴിയെ നിങ്ങൾ പകുത്തോളിൻ പക്ഷേ തുടിയുടലെനിക്കുതരിൻ ശംഖിൻ കുരലെനിക്കുതരിൻ കുഴൽ കരളെനിക്കുതരിൻ തമ്പുരു കുടലെനിക്കുതരിൻ
Beyond the purview of English, untamed by a Western sensibility and untethered by its concerns, exists a vast India that thinks, reads and writes books. These books, written in Indian languages by mature and modern writers, are so completely different in terms of philosophy and style that V.S. Naipaul once described them as the literature of another India. The problem is not simply that a lot of this literature escapes the notice of the West, but because of the many languages it involves, it even eludes most Indians. Which is a pity. Today, contemporary Indian writers who have proven themselves masters in the literature of their respective languages have a readership of over a million each. And their work, though rooted in the language, the land, its people, and their collective unconscious, moves on in the best of literary traditions to seek truths that are universal. And it does so with narrative skills and a stylistic flourish that match the best of writing anywhere in the world. Creative writer, critic, teacher, editor, U.R. Anathamoorthy has had a seminal impact on Kannada literature and culture for several decades. The author of several novels, short stories and plays, some of which have been made into award-winning films, Anathamoorthy is famous for his radical and iconoclastic views, especially on the iniquities of the caste system.
This touch theme began to haunt me from my high school. Touch became a very important theme for me. And it got sociological and cultural significance because our whole Hindu society is based on whom you can touch when and when you can't touch. And the entire untouchability is based on this. Sequence of touchables and untouchables.
Born in 1932 in Mellige, a small village in Karnataka, Anathamoorthy's early education was in Sanskrit in a traditional pathshala. Despite his Brahminical roots, Anathamoorthy acquired a grounding in socialist ideology while still at school. Later, he studied English at the Maharaja's College in Mysore before travelling to London to study under Malcolm Bradbury. Much of Anathamoorthy's writing is, however, imbued with the impressions and memories of his early childhood in the village, which was like a universe to him, complex, secretive, and fraught with intrigue. It also provided him with intense perspectives of life lived within one's caste, perspectives which his writing would later engage with and question. Though his creative material was already being fashioned by his childhood, it was only after watching a particularly evocative Bergman film with Bradbury that Anathamoorthy was inspired to write his path-breaking first work, Samskara.
I had seen a film, it was a Bergman film, which had no subtitles. And I was a little puzzled by the film. And I told my guide, you know, who was also a novelist, a British novelist called Bradbury, look, Malcolm, you know, a European has to go to a library to find out about the medieval times. I think it was Seventh Seal. The medieval times, you know, you acquire it from a library. But the medieval times are in me, in my own consciousness. I am as much a modern person as a medieval person in my memories. And then I used a phrase which I still remember. Centuries coexist in us.
Samskara. Written in 1965, shook the Kannada world with its strong anti-Brahmin stance and its rage against the caste system. But as with all great writing, Anathamoorthy's views are never simplistic, and the book is deeply layered by the conflicting pulls of his intellectual position and his cultural inheritance.
I became very critical of the caste system, you know, from early on. Also the influence of Gandhi and my own experiences, you know, as I was growing up. And it was in the general areas, you know, questioning the traditional modes of existence. But at the same time, it is not as simple as that.
8 years later, in 1973, Anathamoorthy wrote Bharatipura, a novel about the troubled years that led up to the emergency. This novel marked a shift in his writing from the rural villages to mafosil towns. Many of his socialist friends felt betrayed by this novel, as it seemed to hint at a disillusionment with the very idea of change and revolution. The truth is, this was merely a period of self-doubt and despair for the author, and the novel Bharatipura was in fact a sincere effort to overcome this. In 1995, after a writing career that had spanned three decades and seen scores of felicitations and awards, Anathamoorthy was awarded India's highest literary award, the Gyanpeeth. While Anathamoorthy's fiction is layered by his social dialectics, Mahashweta Devi is a writer-activist. Intensely driven by a social conscience, Mahashweta sees her role as that of helping in the upliftment of people, especially the tribals of Bengal. Activist, social worker, reporter, journalist, Mahashweta Devi's works are profoundly influenced by the Naxalbari movement, the most radical social movement of the last few decades. Born in 1926 to Manish Khattak, a poet and novelist, and Dharitri Devi, a writer and social worker, Mahashweta was brought up in a liberal and educated household. The publication of Orunner Odhikar, or Rights Over the Forest, in 1977 established Mahashweta's position as a leading novelist of Bengal and as one of the most powerful writers in India today. She graduated from Shantiniketan in 1946 at a time of great upheaval and change. The peasant movement of Tebhaga was at its height and Calcutta was in the throes of communal riots. The brutal suppression of the Naxalbari movement in the 70s led to several of the activists being thrown into prison. The best known of Mahashweta Devi's novels, which portrays these troubled and exciting times, is Hajar Chaurasi Ki Maa, or The Mother of Number 1084. Today, at 73, Mahashweta Devi continues to be as passionately involved in her cause as ever. Every minute of her time is taken up meeting people, answering correspondence and travelling into the interiors of West Bengal. Has a life dedicated to social work compromised Mahashweta, the writer? Mahashweta confesses that she spends 16 hours a day on writing that has nothing to do with literature.
For years, writing has been my only source of income. And that did not stop me from going to the bonded laborers of Palamo, up to Singhbhum in the very first phase of Jharkhand movement, not the Jharkhand movement of today. Even at in those days, I went there, I wrote about them, searching for where their tribal laborers are dying from asbestosis or silicosis. I wrote articles on them. I went to brick fields about their stories, about their misery, and not only that, tried to do as much for them as I could by taking their cases to government, relevant governments of Bengal and Bihar, and to get them relief in Bengal also, in many fields. But that did not stop me from writing.
The fact that Mahashweta Devi has still managed to create a huge corpus of 41 novels, 15 short story collections and 2 historical biographies is reason enough for the superwoman stature that she has achieved today. Quite unlike the educated family background of Mahashweta Devi, M.T. Vasudevan Nair, mentor to a whole generation of writers in Malayalam, is primarily of agrarian stock. The most popular living writer in Kerala today and the recipient of India's highest literary award, the Gyanpeeth, M.T. is equally famous as an editor and filmmaker. The youngest of 4 children, M.T. was born in the quiet village of Kaddalur in central Kerala. His was an idyllic small-town childhood until disaster struck his sleepy little town as famine, cholera and a cyclone ravaged Kaddalur. M.T. Vasudevan Nair was witness to a scale of destruction and suffering that he couldn't even have imagined existed. It was an experience that was to stay with him forever, drawing some of his loveliest stories from its poignant memories. In 1954, M.T. won the Kerala Sahitya Academy Award for his novel Nalluketu. Based on the breaking down of the old matriarchal system of Kerala, the novel took their Malayalam reading world by storm. In 1970, his second novel, Kalam, received the Sahitya Academy Award, and his film Nirmalam, written, produced and directed by him, won the President's Gold Medal in 1973. M.T. is supposed to be largely responsible for the resurgence of short fiction in Malayalam. Unlike the fiery socialist realists of his time, his work is gentle and warm, yet suffused with tragic undertones. His vision is quintessentially modern, successfully blending inner and outer landscapes and laying bare the conflict between traditional family values in a decadent feudalistic society.
I wanted to understand man more and more, the enigma called man, how he is reacting in a certain way. Formerly, we had, during the 40s, 30s and 40s, my seniors, they were dealing with the material problems. Like poverty, like the exploitation of the masses, exploitation of the workers, the peasants, etc. That was strong material. Now, because of the strong leftist movement of Kerala, certain things were rectified. So, we are using other materials. We are finding the problems of the inner world.
The author of 20 anthologies of short stories, 8 novels and 57 screenplays, almost all of which have won an award of some sort, M.T. Vasudevan Nair is one Indian writer who rightly claims a cult status. If M.T. Vasudevan Nair's canvas is seemingly serene, the works of Krishna Sobti are explosive, provocative and always controversial. An energetic, feisty woman, Sobti is inherently iconoclastic and impatient of stereotypes, be they culturally or gender dictated. Born in 1925 in a part of Gujarat, West Punjab, which is now in Pakistan, but brought up in New Delhi, Sobti experienced diverse worlds. Though from a progressive family herself, she was not unfamiliar with the pardad world of her female friends. In 1968, Krishna Sobti created a stir with the publication of Mitro Marchani, an explicit and uninhibited novel about the sexual awakening of a young rustic Punjabi lass. Written with the earthy flavor of rural Punjab and a relish for double meanings and innuendos, Sobti displayed a sort of hearty candor in this book that was not common in Indian writing at that time. Not surprising then that Mitro Marchani deeply agitated literary circles. Sobti, however, had clear literary reasons for a fictional style in Mitro Marchani. Her protagonist was an illiterate, rustic woman who could only be authentically portrayed in bold brushstrokes and not in the subtle colors of polite society.
I was in Rajasthan, and at that time I was governess to His Highness Abu Tej Singh. Just by chance, I saw a group of laborers working, and there was a very beautiful girl. I couldn't see her face. She had a ghongkart on and a beautiful body. And she was talking to the contractor. And she laughed. This is all the laughter I could hear. And she says, "Don't look at me. Mujhse mat, mujhe meri taraf mat dekho, bharma jaoge." And I didn't take it, the way things were spoken. I took it as a very serious matter. It kept on with me for a very long time. One sentence that could have been objected to by Hindi reader. And that was, you know, she was now gazing her, Mitra was gazing at herself, you know. And I think that was the moment that was caught up by them. They usually don't miss, you know, a real historical moment, you know. And here was a woman, she was always, woman, Indian woman, was looked at, you know, by the male. But now she was looking at herself, you know, saying, I've got wonderful breasts, you know. And that seemed like a meaningful thing to them.
The most significant political event of Krishna Sobti's generation was the partition, and the brutal, blood-stained drama of the communal divide was an intensely experienced reality for her. Out of the horrific memories of personal and historic loss was born the Sahitya Academy Award-winning Zindagi Nama. Written in 1980, the novel is a sweeping chronicle of pre-partition rural Punjab and is suffused with the ambience and ethos of that time. Actively shedding the constraints of gender, about 20 years ago, Krishna Sobti invented a male alter ego for herself, Hashmat Mia. This was the result of a long and firmly held belief in the concept of the Ardhanarishwar. Under the guise of Hashmat Mia, Sobti began a sort of writing which was not only different in tone and content, but interestingly, different even in its physical form.
It suddenly happened. I always thought I was not interested in small talks, you know, in what is happening to this person, what is happening to that. There was always a kind of a kind of feeling that your friends, they almost disappoint you by getting into small groups. When I came back from a party, I thought I've got something, you know, to say. I just entered my study, I stood there for 5 minutes, and I knew something has happened. And this word came to me, Hashmat. Hashmat is a name, you know, just like myself, you know. I thought it suits my face, you know, very solid, you know, and maybe that is not all that sharp, you know. And I kept on, I started writing, and it opened a different life before me. I was the same person, you know, but I also created a different writing for myself, you know. It was very sort of, very definite writing. Otherwise, with Sobti, I write, you know, this way. With Hashmat, I write this way. And I think while I was doing it, you know, I had the feeling that to say that gender is literature is not all right.
Though Sobti modestly describes herself as a liberal middle-class woman, the truth is that in both of her literary avatars, Krishna Sobti is a writer with great courage and skills, who has carved a distinct niche for herself in the annals of Hindi literature. Like Krishna Sobti, Nirmal Varma writes in Hindi. But while Sobti examines her characters against external situations like the partition, Nirmal Varma's fictive scape is more internal, private, and preoccupied with existential anguish. Born in 1929 in Shimla, Nirmal Varma spent his childhood in the mountains before moving to Delhi, where he studied history at St. Stephen's College. In 1959, Nirmal went to Prague and stayed there for 7 years. Later, he lived in Iceland, England, and the United States. This extensive travel influenced Nirmal's work greatly. It layered his insights on human dilemmas and loneliness, and helped him expand his themes. Set in different locales and countries, Nirmal's writing broke literary ground in Hindi with its cosmopolitan tone and subjects.
I felt that people living in the big urban cities like Bombay, Delhi, Calcutta, their inner world cannot be depicted in the same simplistic, realistic manner as it used to be done in the 30s and in the 40s. A certain degree of complexity and subtlety had to be achieved in order to capture the vicissitudes of their life after independence.
Initially held at arm's length by a conservative literary establishment, Nirmal's subtle, sophisticated language and his urban, cosmopolitan characters provided a significant shift from the predominant Premchand school of social realism and rustic themes. Because of this, Nirmal is popularly seen as the father of the Nai Kahani movement in Hindi literature, a tag he's acutely uncomfortable with. He discards such tags as simply artificial and academic exercises. Renowned for their lyrical, poetic quality, Varma's stories gently probe subtle emotional and psychological states of the human mind. He lays bare the bleak, benumbed mindscapes of the modern, urban Indian besieged by feelings of alienation and existential doubt. And though his work is dominated by interpersonal encounters, there's an undefinable yearning, a quality of ache in the relations between Nirmal's fictive men and women.
Our Indian society before independence, before the war, was more static. It had a greater stability, inner stability, a joint family system. The man-woman relationship, though was extremely unfair, had a certain conventional status and dignity about it. But after independence, and because of the mass migration of people for jobs and employment from villages to towns, to big towns, and this faith in the traditional family kinship relationships completely disintegrated. People found that they have to live on their own as individuals. Secondly, the status of woman changed. You know, woman was no longer now a person who's to be treated as sister, wife, mother, that they had a very stereotyped status in the family. Now, as a woman became as an individual human being, the entire configuration of relationship between man and woman, between woman and society, and therefore the fictional landscape also revolving around man-woman relationship also underwent a radical change.
Nirmal Varma is best known for his collection of short stories, Kauwe or Kala Pani, which won him the Sahitya Academy Award in 1986. Most of Nirmal's work, like his novel Lal Teen Ki Chhat, is touched by an underlying tone of Chekhovian sadness. A small, soft-spoken man, Nirmal's unassuming ways belie the enormous influence he has wielded on contemporary Hindi literature. About the same time that Gabriel Garcia Marquez was writing A Hundred Years of Solitude, O.V. Vijayan was writing Kazakinte Itihasam, or The Legends of Kazakh, a powerful and truly gifted exponent of the magic realist school long before it was fashionable. Vijayan created a storm with his book, The Legends of Kazakh, which stands comparison with Marquez's classic. Kazakh proved a watershed book in Malayalam literature, and it made Vijayan a cult writer.
My previous writing, well, in a way, suggests this kind of a blossoming, but I'm not very sure. I keep on recollecting the days I spent thinking of this novel or writing in parts. I was young then. I had this great love for cycling through the wilderness. And when Palghat countryside was full of canal, irrigation canals and cycle tracks where total solitude you could experience. The wind in my body, the wind coming through the shirt, the kind of the gentle speed over the greenery, waterways. I was taking in a lot of sensory, a wealth of sensory data, unconsciously.
Vijayan has over the years been a man of many parts: novelist, cartoonist, translator and journalist. In each of his callings, he has been served excellently by his unforgiving eye, his graphic pen and his blackly satiric point of view. Born in 1930 in Palghat in Kerala, Vijayan had no formal education till the age of 12. He spent his time reading fairy tales and absorbing the stories that his grandmother told him. The son of a police officer, he spent his time surrounded by armed constables. And perhaps his deep irreverence for authority can find its roots here. Vijayan's second novel, Dharma Puranam, was begun in 1972, but did not find a good Malayalam publisher for quite a while on account of what left and progressive critics considered an imperialist slant, and his own readers considered obscenity. Vijayan's later novels have moved away from the satiric to an increasing mysticism, as an infirm Vijayan has steadily retreated from the world to complete reclusiveness. Vijayan spends all his waking hours writing and translating, fearful that his time is running out. Super bilingualism is another of Vijayan's rare gifts. He writes in English with the same felicity that he brings to Malayalam, and he has undertaken the translation of all his works himself. This tends to take away a lot of his writing time, and consequently, Vijayan has a seemingly small oeuvre of 4 novels and a few dozen short stories. But the shadow they cast in Indian literature is very, very long. The fact of the matter is that modern Indian literature is both vigorous and purposive. There's a determined breaking of shibboleths, a bold experimenting with forms and language, and a sincere attempt to expose social evils. All the signs of a vitally alive and continually evolving corpus of literature. However, though the translation of Indian texts is finally catching on, and writers like these masters have been made available to readers in English, there are many more whose work, locked in the cryptic symbols of different languages, which lack the media glare and commercial strengths of English, remains tragically unsung.